Are there systematic differences between male and female leaders? Do these differences affect organizations helmed by women? In the context of political leaders, one area where these questions are potentially very important is foreign policy. In particular, the decision to go to war. This is one of the most consequential decisions a state can make, and it is one where the national leader plays a pivotal role. But while it is commonly believed that women are less violent than men, and therefore less likely to lead their countries to war, there has been relatively little empirical work on this question. This paper addresses that gap by studying how female monarchs affected war between European states over the period from 1480 to 1913. Over this 400-year period, were queens less prone to conflict than kings? To answer this question, the authors compiled a dataset tracking wars between European polities since the 15th century, matched with detailed information on their rulers. Their sample covers 193 reigns and includes the 18 polities shown here, all of which had at least one queen over this period. Now, the key obstacle in studying the link between queens and the prevalence of conflict is that both are likely to be correlated with other factors. For example, it's possible that polities were more likely to accept a female monarch in periods of relative peace. In this case, even if the reigns of female rulers tended to coincide with reduced conflict, this would not reflect that given the same circumstances, queens were less prone to conflict than kings. To overcome this problem, the authors utilized the rules governing dynastic succession. In polities where the crown was passed through a family line, two arbitrary biological factors affected the probability that a woman would ascend to the throne. First, whether the current monarch had a sister, and second, whether they had a firstborn child who was male. While the former increased the probability that the throne would subsequently pass to a female ruler, the latter decreased that probability. The authors confirmed these relationships in their data. The presence of a sister increased the probability of a queenly reign by 29 percentage points, while the presence of a firstborn male reduced it by 17 to 24 percentage points. Thus, to estimate the causal effect of female rule on external conflict, the authors leverage cases where queens ascended to the throne as a result of these arbitrary factors. And contrary to the conventional wisdom, they find that polities led by queens were actually more prone to conflict than polities led by kings. While average war participation was 30 percentage points, queens were 39 percentage points more likely to engage in conflict. These results are not driven by queens inheriting wars started by previous monarchs, nor by conflicts over succession. So, why did female rule lead to increased conflict? One potential explanation is that queens were perceived as vulnerable targets by other rulers and were thus constantly attacked by others. However, the authors find that their results are largely driven by wars in which the queen's polity initiated the attack, rather than by wars in which they were attacked by others. This suggests that perceived weakness cannot fully explain the results. Instead, the authors explore a second potential mechanism: differences in state capacity. Wars required substantial investments of money and resources, and queens may have had greater capacity than kings to pursue them due to differences in how they utilized their spouses. While queens often enlisted their husbands to help them rule, for example, by putting them in charge of the military or fiscal reforms, kings rarely enlisted their wives in a similar fashion. This greater spousal division of labor may have increased the capacity of queenly reigns and enabled them to engage in more conflicts. To test this theory, the authors disaggregate their results according to marital status. When restricting to unmarried monarchs, queens were more likely to be attacked than kings. This is consistent with the idea that unmarried queens, in particular, may have been viewed as vulnerable targets. Married queens, however, were more likely to initiate external conflicts than married kings. While these comparisons by marital status are more suggestive than the aggregate results, they are consistent with the idea that differences in spousal norms enhanced the state capacity of queens relative to kings and allowed them to pursue more aggressive policies abroad. In conclusion, this paper shows that in the context of Europe over the 15th to 20th centuries, queens engaged in more interstate wars than kings. To what extent can we extrapolate from these results? The authors caution that the effects of female rule in the era of hereditary succession may not translate directly to the modern day. Nonetheless, these results are informative for the idea that male and female leaders may choose to organize their rule differently, and present a counterpoint to the idea that states led by women will necessarily be more peaceful and conciliatory than states led by men. To read more on this topic, you can check out the full paper and its references to other research. These include the broader question of whether leaders matter, and within this a subset of papers studying female leadership in both political and corporate contexts, experimental papers on gender differences and competitiveness, and finally, research on the historical determinants of conflict.